today is the 8th day of the 7th month on our Creator's restored calendar. It is September 12th on the calendar that Satan established in order to profane the Most High's appointed times. Counting today, there are just 14 days and 14 nights that remain in Kippur Elohim's 42-month witness against those of you who are of the scattered descendants of Israel. The 1,260 days of these 42 30-day months contain his restored Sabbaths and the rest of his restored appointed times in them. The Most High has sent his end-time Son of Man to you with the testimony of his word, and he has established this restoration through the testimony of his word. He has plucked me from your midst and sent me to you with the testimony of his word, testifying that he has sent me. And he has made his witness against you about your refusal to believe the testimony of his word. I can assure you that it is not a coincidence that his only begotten Son told us that all will be judged by his Father's word at the end of this era of time. The testimony of Yahweh's word has not been good enough for nearly all of you to cause you to know that he has sent me to you, nor has it been good enough to cause you to believe his restoration of all things. You want to see some sort of sign instead? Well, you are soon going to get the sign that your wicked, uncircumcised, unbelieving hearts desire. You are going to receive wave after wave of signs, and you are not going to like them. Yeshua told us in Matthew chapter 12, but he answered and said to them, a wicked and an adulterous generation searches for or desires a sign, and there will be no sign given to it except for the sign of the prophet Jonah. You are a wicked and an adulterous generation because you do not believe the testimony of the Most High's word. You are a wicked and an adulterous generation because you play the whore to him by loving and worshiping idolatrous images of who you want him to be in your wicked, rebellious, unbelieving, and uncircumcised hearts. In the last video, I pointed out that the Hebrew word for Jonah is the same word for dove. Therefore, the sign of Jonah is the sign of the dove. The second dove that Yahweh's servant Noah let loose brought back an olive branch to the ark. Yahweh's word testifies that the olive branch is symbolic of his two witnesses that his word tells us are his two anointed sons. Therefore, the sign of Jonah can also be called the sign of Yahweh's two witnesses. Yeshua gave our ancestors many signs to prove that he was sent by the Most High. His Father healed the sick through his only begotten Son. He opened the eyes of the blind through him. The lame walked. He walked on water and much, much more. Not only this, Yahweh's word testifies that he had sent him. So when Yeshua spoke this about there being no other sign that would be given to the wicked and adulterous generation, he was giving a parable about a specific sign that would be for a specific event. And the following verses tell us that this specific event would accompany the generation that would be at the time of the judgment. The Most High established the first tier of the sign of Jonah with his son being in the tomb for 3 days and three nights. The timing that Yeshua was murdered in the middle of the afternoon, along with other prophecies that are recorded in Yahweh's word, along with the timing of the Passover and the timing of Yeshua's resurrection, set the stage for the second tier of this sign. The second tier of this sign was the Most High revealing to us how this timing mirrored the timing of his backup Passover opportunity of the second month, and how this backup Passover opportunity overlaps his record of the flood with the timing of when he told his servant Noah to start loading the ark on the 10th day of the month through when he sent the waters gushing upon the earth 7 days later. Here is some trivia for you. 7 days later, from his commanded observance of his Day of Atonement, that is in just 2 days, is the third day of his commanded observance of his Feast of Huts. It is the 17th day of the 7th month. The 17th day of the 7th month is the day that he recorded that he marked his servant Noah. The second tier of the sign of Jonah testifies that he did so towards the end of this day, before the 18th day began. It is 5 months after he sent the floodwaters gushing upon the earth. It is 6 months after he resurrected his only begotten Son. The first tier of the sign of Jonah testifies that he resurrected Yeshua towards the end of the 17th day of the first month before the 18th day began. At the beginning of the Most High's 42-month witness against you, he wove these two tiers of this sign into a third tier that testified to his restoration of his 30-day months. He did so in a remarkable way. He did so through similitudes of the prophecies that he had recorded in his word, like his word tells us he was going to do. He orchestrated the beginning of this 1,260-day period of time to begin with three 30-day periods on each side of the day that he led me to scatter the last one-third of my hair that I scattered per his Ezekiel chapter 5 Son of Man prophecy. The details that he wove into the timing of this tier, of this sign, along with the volume of prophecies that he gave to us in his word that paralleled it, were phenomenal. Not only did he send me to you with this remarkable sign, it is his word that testifies that he has sent his end time Son of Man to you, just like it is his word that testifies that he sent his only begotten Son, Yeshua, to our ancestors. But instead of believing his word, like our ancestors, you want a physical sign. You want to see fireworks. Well, like I said, you are soon going to get your desire. You are not going to get to see the sign of me lying dead upon your wide pathway of Sodom and Egypt, because the Most High has already established through the resurrection of his only begotten Son that such a sign would not cause you to hearken to him anyway. Yahweh already gave you the sign of his only begotten Son's resurrection. You say that you believe this sign, yet even though you say that you believe it, it is not good enough to cause you to hearken neither to the Most High nor to his only begotten Son. Yeshua told us that we have to follow him in order to be given eternal life in his Father's kingdom. Following him is walking as he walked, and he lived by every word that his father sent forth from his mouth. Instead, you follow a wolf that came to our ancestors in sheep's clothing. You follow the abomination that desolated Yahweh Elohim's word. You follow Saul of Tarsus's more excellent way. In verse 40, for as Jonah was 3 days and three nights in the belly of the great fish, so will the Son of Man be 3 days and three nights in the heart of the earth. Yahweh's word clearly calls both of his two witnesses the Son of Man. His word does so because he has sent his two witnesses to you to testify that we must live our lives in the flesh, walking with him in his word, being his sons and daughters as men and women, in order to become his eternal children when we leave our lives in the flesh. We have to first be his children as men and women in the flesh. If you are not walking with him in his word plainly declares that he has cut you off from being his children. To deny this is to call his word a lie. But you do deny this, and you say that you are his children in spite of his word saying that you are not. His first witness says that you are of your father the devil because you do not abide in or live in the truth. This is recorded in John chapter 8, verse 44. In John chapter 17, verse 17, he tells us that the truth is his Father's word that purifies us. Therefore, if you are not living his word, you are of your father Satan. This cannot be put any simpler. To deny this is to deny the testimony of Yahweh Elohim's first Son of Man. And it is to deny the testimony of his second Son of Man that he has sent to you at this time. Living his word in the flesh is the vehicle that the Most High uses to circumcise our hearts and to teach us to be as he is. Becoming as he is the entire purpose of why he put us here in the flesh. His word says so. It does so in the beginning of his word in Genesis chapter 1. And Elohim said, I will make man in my image after my likeness, and I will let him have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the fowls of the air and over the cattle and over all of the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. So Elohim created man to become in his image. He created him to become in the image of Elohim. If you refute this, then why did he put you here? Are you here to be as you are, or be as you want to be, and simply eat, drink, and be merry, and tomorrow you die? No. Isaiah chapter 55 tells us that he sent his down word from heaven in order for it to teach us his way, and to teach us to think like he does. Back to Matthew chapter 12, the men in Nineveh will stand up in the judgment with this generation and will condemn it, because they turned back at the preaching of Jonah. And behold, or look and see, a greater than Jonah is here. Yahweh sent his servant Jonah to the wicked city of Nineveh, and they hearkened to his servant's warning. Contrast this with your failure to do so at this time. He has sent his second anointed son to the scattered descendants of Israel. Look and see, perceive and discern, how much greater is his doing so. But unlike the men of Nineveh, you have not hearkened to his servant. Yahweh did not send his servant Jonah to the men of Nineveh with the testimony of his word testifying that he had sent him like he has done with his second anointed son at this time. How much greater is his doing so in this manner at this time, especially since most of you claim that you do believe his word? Is it his word that you claim to believe to be much esteemed? Should a man sent to pale from being in a great fish's belly be more feared than the Yahweh Elohim's word? No, the sign that he has sent me to you with is much greater than the sign of his servant Jonah being in the belly of the great fish for 3 days and three nights. The testimony of his word is a much greater sign if you fear his word. But you have rejected the testimony of his word. You have done so because you do not fear his word. How do you think that this is going to work out for you if you continue to do so? Going on in verse 42, the queen of the south will awaken in the judgment with this generation and will condemn it, because she came from the uttermost parts of the earth to hear the wisdom of Solomon, and behold, or look and see, a greater than Solomon is here. Is it arrogance for me to make such a claim? Was it arrogance for his only begotten son to make this claim? No, it is the testimony of my father's word that testifies that I am his second anointed son of his Zechariah chapter 4 prophecy. It is his word that testifies that he has plucked me from your midst and made me to be his second witness. The arrogance is in your court because you are risen up in pride and in arrogance above the testimony of his word. Therefore you are risen up in pride and in arrogance above the Most High himself, and you are in this state with no fear of him whatsoever. When Yahweh gave Solomon the incredible wisdom and understanding and wealth that he gave to him, people esteemed him and they increased his fame and his wealth. How much more should you do so for one that his word tells us he has put his word upon and sent to tell you what is recorded in his scriptures of truth? It is his word that testifies that he has put his word upon me and sent me to tell you what is recorded in his scriptures of truth. Here are the two most obvious places that it does. In Zechariah chapter 4, and the angel that spoke to me answered and said to me, "Do you not know what these are?" Zechariah was referring to the two olive trees that he was shown. And I said, "No, master." The angel answered and spoke to me, saying, "This is Yahweh's word that is upon Zerubbabel, saying, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit," referring to by his seven spirits, says Yahweh of hosts. The Most High did not send out his seven spirits through Solomon. He only gave him wisdom and understanding. Yet the queen of the south came from the uttermost part of the earth to seek this wisdom and understanding. And she, along with others, brought him great wealth when they did so. Yet only five have come to the Most High servant that he has given his seven spirits upon at this time. And four of these five left his servant quickly. They left because of his righteous admonishments. This is incredible. Yahweh rebukes and chastens those who he loves. His word says so. Isn't fleeing from his admonishment a terrible thing to do? Shouldn't a child desire to be admonished by their father so that they can learn to please him in the future? Or is it better to run away from and hide from the admonishment? It might be better for a short season, but in the long run, hiding from his admonishment will prove to be futile. His word bids for all males to come before him at the place that he has placed his name on his three harvest feasts, and to not do so empty-handed. The last of the 10 harvest feasts that are in his 42-month witness against you is near at hand, and there remains just one other standing with his anointed in his camp. This is remarkable. At the time of the most recent of these feasts, one of the five that have come to his camp actually headed the opposite direction prior to this feast. And this man says that he does believe that the Most High has sent me to restore all things. He sent me a text that said that it was the Most High who told him to go the other way. How can that be? We have to measure the voice that is guiding us with his word. We must measure all things with his word. If it goes against his word, it is not from him. It is from the enemy. Yahweh's word is the measuring line that his temple of first fruits was built with. If his word commands us to do something, how can we think that it is possibly his word that is telling us to not do it or to go the opposite way? But at least this man has made an effort to hearken to the Most High's instructions to sustain his anointed at this time, and so have four others. Three of these five are of the five men that have come to the Most High's camp. One of them remains in his camp. Two of them were cut off from the Most High because they spoke against two of the five that came to his camp were cut off from the Most High because they spoke against that which his seven spirits have testified to. It is awesome that the Most High has risen up two others in their stead to help sustain his servant, but these two have not come to his camp, and as far as I know, they remain with the dead. I have recently heard from one of the other two that has come to his camp. He wrote me to tell me that he has fled to the mountains of Scotland. And the last time that I heard from the other, he told me that he was planning to flee from the dead. But neither of them have returned to the place that the Most High has placed his name. How could there be a better place to be on the planet Earth than standing with his anointed? And where is the great wealth that was brought into his physical temple in the days of Solomon, now that one that is greater than he is here? Can you not see how his anger is kindled at this time for your failure to hearken to his word? Going on, verse 7, who are you, great mountain, referring to the high and the lofty ones that are standing in arrogance before the Most High's face at this time? Before Zerubbabel's face you will become a plain, and he will bring forth the headstone, referring to Yeshua, the other olive tree that Zechariah was shown in the previous verses, shouting favor for favor to him. And in Daniel chapter 10, then he said, do you know from where I have come to you? Henceforth I will turn back to consume those who are with the prince of Persia. I will go forth, and behold, a prince or a head steward will come to you from Greece. Truly at this time, Yahweh Elohim will declare to you that which is recorded in his scriptures the truth, through the one that his seven spirits are upon. And there is not one that will seize, and a word that also means that will restore with him in these things, except for Michael his prince, Michael his head steward. In lieu of this, and in lieu of his word testifying that I am this Michael, and in lieu of the great and the fearful day of his wrath being at hand, you would think that there would be nothing that could keep any of you back from coming from the uttermost parts of the earth to hear what his word tells us firsthand. But except for those whom the Most High has let see some things in order to call you to him for a specific purpose, the rest of you cannot see that the one that is greater than Solomon has been sent to you. This is because of your pride and your arrogance. And in your pride and arrogance, the Most High has given you over to believe into lies that are the captivity of Mystery Babylon. He did so because you did not do my judgments, he says, and you despised my statutes, and you profaned my Sabbaths, and your eyes were on following after your father's idolatries. So I gave you over to statutes and to judgments that were not good, and that would not save your lives. He has shut off your eyes from being able to see, and he has stopped your ears from being able to hear his word. And as long as you remain in the obstinacy of your hearts in refusing to believe his word, you are going to remain in this condition until he destroys your cities. This is recorded in Isaiah chapter 6. And he said, go and tell this people that hearing they will hear, but they will not understand, and seeing they will see, but they will not perceive. The hearts of this people are waxed fat, and I have caused their ears to be heavy, and I have shut their eyes, lest they would see with their eyes and hear with their ears, and understand with their hearts, and turn back, or and repent, and be healed. Then I said, Adonai, how long will this be? And he answered, until the cities are wasted without inhabitant, and the houses are without man, and the land is desolated to devastation. It is amazing that you are this stiff-necked and obstinate. The good news is your arrogance is soon going to be brought to an end. He's going to cause you to believe his word. And so will you be put to an end if you continue to refuse to come down off of your high and lofty mountains and look and see your shame and humbly turn back to the Most High. Since you refuse to do so and you refuse to believe his word, he is going to show you the shame of your nakedness in a way that will cause you to know that his word is true and that it is from him. Thus saith Yahweh Elohim of hosts,